Hello and welcome to Unacademy. I am Rajshekar Reddy, faculty for Current Affairs, and we will be having a mock test today on Current Affairs. Current Affairs is a very, very important component on the civil service examination. You can expect at least 20 to 25 questions on Current Affairs. So you have to be very strong as far as Current Affairs is concerned. And the sources of Current Affairs. So many people study various books, but the best source is to read the Hindu newspaper. Apart from reading the Hindu newspaper, it is also advised to read the Indian Express. In addition to that, you need to follow the updates released by the Government of India through the Press Information Bureau. And it is better to follow an academy on Current Affairs. So if you follow these four sources, then your preparation as far as Current Affairs is concerned is more or less complete. So before conducting today's mock exam, I would like to tell something about myself and about the Unacademy. So I am Rajshekar Reddy, faculty for Current Affairs. I have cleared the civil service examination in 2014. I'm a BTech computer science graduate from JNTU Hyderabad, and I have 7 years experience teaching Current Affairs. So I hope my experience will be very useful for you to crack this exam. So you need to download and take the plus subscription of the Unacademy. So by doing so, you get a number of advantages. So these include daily live classes. In these classes, you can chat with your educator, ask questions, engage in discussions, as well as answer polls all during the class. So these classes are interactive in nature. Further, the courses that are available on the app are structured in nature, so they comprehensively deal with the syllabus of the civil service examination. You also have live tests and quizzes conducted by top educators of our country on a regular basis, so they will help you in analyzing where you stand as far as the civil service examination is concerned. And most importantly, you have unlimited access to the content. You can watch these videos any number of times without any restriction on the number of times you can watch these videos, and you can watch them at the time and place of your choice. So as I've told you, there are a number of top educators of our country. These people have designed various courses which are very, very useful for you. And you have a large number of subscription options. You can take the subscription for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months and 24 months. The best option is the 24 month subscription, which gives you a 67% discount. So you can get a 67% discount, and you get an additional 10% discount if you use my code RRUPSC. So please use this code while subscribing to the Unacademy learning app. So the final cost will be 57,600 for 2 years, and you can convert this transaction into no cost EMI, which can be extended up to 24 months. So Unacademy is not just affordable, it is also the best in the country. So you can make a comparison between Unacademy and other offline as well as online coaching institutions, and you can easily come to the conclusion that this platform is the best for civil services coaching online. Okay, so let us start the exam today. So there are 50 questions in this exam. So I hope you actively participate in the exam. So I'll read the question, I'll give you some time, and after that I'll explain the answer to you. So let us start with the first question of today's examination. So let us see how many of you can answer this. Which of the following organizations releases the Purchasing Managers Index, so PMI? So which organization releases the PMI? You hardly have 20 days left for the examination, so it is better that you do as many questions as possible. You need to first finish the previous papers. After that, you need to do the mock test. You need not be demoralized. if you get less marks in the mock test, because these are just sample questions. But definitely, please complete the previous papers first. Okay, let us see the answer. So, which of the following organizations releases the Purchasing Managers Index? So, the answer is IHS Markit. So, Purchasing Managers Index is released every month. And it gives an indication of the performance of a country in the manufacturing sector as well as the services sector. So there will be two purchasing managers index, so two PMIs. So PMI for manufacturing, PMI for services. So this is a private index. So this is an released by a private organization. The government, on the other hand, releases an index called IIP, that is the Index of Industrial Production. Both these are important. And on the basis of the numbers of both these indexes, we can come to a conclusion as to the performance of the manufacturing sector. How is the manufacturing sector performing in India can be analyzed from these two numbers. So Purchasing Managers Index has a peculiar number. So if the value of PMI is more than 50, then you say that the industry is expanding. So if the value of the Purchasing Managers Index is more than 50, then you say that the industry is expanding. And if it is less than 50, then you say that the industry is contracting. So it is always better to have a number which is more than 50. The more the number, that is if it is 65, 70, then you say that it is rapid expansion. However, if the number is just 51, 51.5, 52, then it indicates that the industry is expanding, but the expansion is quite slow, slowly expanding. So this is the meaning of the Purchasing Managers Index. So Purchasing Managers Index is released by private organizations. The most important private organization which releases the index is IHS Markit. This is an organization, if I am not wrong, is based in London. So they release this index for every country in the world. So indexes, as I have already told you several times in the past, they are very important for the examination. So let us see the next question. Consider the following products: pan masala, aerated waters, motor vehicles not exceeding 1500 cc, and gold. So I have given you four products, and on which of these products is the GST compensation says levied? So let us see. So both Akash and Neelam have said that all are correct. So were both of you are wrong. So on pan masala, first of all, GST compensation is something which is in the news. As you all know, the states have protested against the decision of the government not to compensate. So the government of India has said we will not be in a position to compensate the shortfall in revenue. And they have described it as an act of God. And they said that you need to borrow from the RBI or the market. So there will be a shortfall of 2,35,000 crores in the GST collections, according to the government of India. There actually will be a shortfall of 3 lakh crores. Out of the 3 lakh crores, 65,000 crores will be collected in the form of GST compensation cess. So there is a cess which is levied on certain class of goods, and these goods are called demerit goods or sin goods. This cess is levied for a period of 5 years, starting 1st of July 2017 to 1st of July 2022. Okay, so this cess will be imposed on a set of goods. So there are a number of goods. For example, we have pan masala. Yes. So this, the amount that is collected through this cess will be used to compensate the states. So however, the GST which will be collected through this cess is just 65,000 crores this year. So there will be still a shortfall of 2,35,000 crores. This is a point which you need to remember. Okay, so what are the products on which the GST cess is imposed, levied? So the pan masala, yes, this will be levied. Then aerated waters, yes. Motor vehicles not exceeding 1500cc, yes. Gold, no. So GST cess is not levied on gold. So the answer for this question is A, B and C only. So you can refer the internet, you can check in the internet. There is an act called GST Compensation to States Act 2017, and this act lists, so there is a list of products on which the GST compensation cess is levied. A cess is a tax on tax, so it is a specific tax which is levied on a tax, and it is collected only for a specific purpose. So only for a specific purpose it is collected. The amount that is collected by the central government through a cess need not be shared with the states. So these are some of the important points which you need to note as far as GST compensation cess is concerned. So GST compensation cess is not levied on gold. So let us see the next question. Which of the following conventions has the feature called the challenge inspection? Which of the following conventions has a feature called the challenge inspection? So let us see how many of you have answered this. Only Neelam has answered. Neelam says the answer is 2. So the answer for this is Chemical Weapons Convention. Yes, she is correct. So there is a convention which is called the Chemical Weapons Convention. This entered into force in the year 1997. According to this convention, all chemicals which can be used as chemical weapons are banned. So they are banned from production. So there is a prohibition on production, use, sale, stockpile and export of chemical weapons. So you cannot produce chemical weapons, you cannot sell chemical weapons, you cannot use chemical weapons, you cannot store chemical weapons, you cannot export chemical weapons. This is a very, very important convention because chemical weapons are said to be weapons of mass destruction. There are various types of chemical weapons. For example, during the First World War, mustard gas was used extensively and it killed as many as 1 lakh people and injured more than 1 million people. Very recently, this is in the news because of Alexei Navalny. So there is a prominent opposition leader. He is said to have been poisoned using a chemical weapon called Novichok. Novichok is a type of chemical weapon. It is an example of a nerve agent. It is called a nerve agent which affects the nervous system. So which means it is a neurotoxin. So it affects the nervous system. So though Russia is a signatory of the Chemical Weapons Convention, it is producing and using this clandestinely or secretly. So there is a very important organization which has been established under the Chemical Weapons Convention, which is called OPCW, that is the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. OPCW is the organization which has been established. It is located in The Hague. The Hague is the place where this organization is located. Sorry. So The Hague and this carries out inspections. So the chemical facilities in various countries are inspected by the OPCW. An important feature of the Chemical Weapons Convention is a country can challenge another country as far as chemical weapons are concerned. For example, if Russia believes that the United States of America has chemical weapons stored at a particular facility, if they believe that the United States has stored chemical weapons at a particular facility, then they can challenge the United States of America before the OPCW, that is the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. And once a country is challenged, what will happen is, once a particular country is challenged, then there will be what is called surprise inspection. So there will be a surprise inspection which will be launched by the OPCW. So this feature of one country challenging the other is unique to the Chemical Weapons Convention. This is a point which you need to remember. So Chemical Weapons Convention is a very famous convention. There is also the Biological Weapons Convention. We have the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the United Nations Convention Against Torture, but here Chemical Weapons Convention is the most important among these conventions. Okay, India is also a signatory of the Chemical Weapons Convention. So let us see the next question. The number of autonomous district councils in India outside the sixth schedule are, how many autonomous district councils do we have outside the sixth schedule? The number of autonomous district councils outside the sixth schedule. So let us see how many of you can answer this. Okay, let us see. First of all, India, the Constitution of India has the provision of establishing autonomous district councils. So these district councils enjoy autonomy as far as some specific subjects are concerned. These autonomous district councils are usually established under the sixth schedule, which means they can be established in the states of Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram. They have been established on the recommendations of the Gopinath Bordolai committee. So we have a total of 10 autonomous district councils in these four states. In Assam we have 3. These include the Boro Territorial Council, then we have the Dima Hasao Territorial Council, we also have the Karbi Anglong Territorial Council, that is the autonomous district council. In Meghalaya we have 3, that is Garo, Khasi, Jaintia, then we have 1 in Tripura and we have 3 in Mizoram. So the 3 in Mizoram are Lai, Mara and Chakma. So these are the 10 which have been established under the 6th schedule. However, outside the 6th schedule, we have 3 autonomous development councils. So what are they? So we have the Ladakh Hill Area Development Council. So we have 2 Ladakh Hill Area Development Councils, one for Leh and the other for Kargil. So these two have been established by an act of the parliament. Then we also have Darjeeling Gorkha Hill Council. So this is also an autonomous development council. So overall we have a total of 13 autonomous councils. Out of these 13, 10 are established under the 6th schedule and 3 are established outside the 6th schedule. You might have noticed that there was an article in the newspaper saying that the Congress party and other political parties want the elections which are supposed to be held for the Ladakh Hill Area Development Council Leh this year must be postponed. They have requested for the postponement of the elections for this specific autonomous district council because of the situation along the line of actual control. But the BJP wants the elections to be held. So the answer is 3. So number 1. Okay, let us see the next question. The number of US presidents to have won the Nobel Prize till date are. How many US presidents have won the Nobel Prize till date? So this is a topic which is in the news because a Norwegian MP has nominated Donald Trump for the Nobel Peace Prize this year. He actually has nominated him last year also. Again, he nominated him. So last year, he nominated Donald Trump for his efforts to promote peace in the Korean Peninsula. The other reason is, the second reason, that is this year he got nominated, or he was nominated by this Norwegian MP because of his efforts to bring peace in the Middle Eastern region. Donald Trump himself has said that he wishes to be a Nobel laureate. He deserves a Nobel Peace Prize. We will have to wait and see whether Donald Trump will be given the Nobel Peace Prize or not. Let us see how many of you answered this. Akash Gogoi says only 2 persons. So what is the answer? Okay, so the number of presidents to have won the Nobel Peace Prize till date are 4. So for the first time in the year 1906, Theodore Roosevelt was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. So he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts to bring peace between Russia and Japan. So Russia and Japan fought a war in 1904-1905. And in order to promote peace between Russia and Japan, this person was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. He also settled the dispute between USA and Mexico through arbitration. So this is also one of the reasons why Theodore Roosevelt got the Nobel Peace Prize. In 1919, Woodrow Wilson, who is regarded as the father of public administration, so this person was given the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts to bring or establish the League of Nations. So he played a crucial role in the establishment of the League of Nations. League of Nations was later succeeded or replaced by the United Nations. So, in 1919, Woodrow Wilson, the former president, was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. In 2002, Jimmy Carter was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts to promote peace in the Middle East. So, he played an important role in promoting peace between Israel and Egypt. And for these efforts, he was given the Nobel Peace Prize. And finally, in 2009, Barack Obama was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts to promote international cooperation. However, this became very controversial. He was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize within a few months after he entered office. That was quite surprising. So in 2009, Barack Obama was given the Peace Prize. So till date, 4 US presidents have been awarded the Peace Prize. So this is very important. So in 2019 also, the Ethiopian president Abiy Ahmed Ali, so his name is Abiy Ahmed Ali, so this person was given the Peace Prize for his efforts to bring peace between Ethiopia and the neighboring country of Eritrea. So this is also very important. So questions can be asked on the Nobel Prizes, a commonly asked question. So till date, 4 presidents have been given the Nobel Peace Prize. So let us move on to the next question. This is a simple, straightforward question. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. Sustha is a territory disputed between India and which country? Okay, let us see the answer. So Neelam has said that the answer is Nepal. Yes, very good. Nepal is the country with which we have this dispute. So with Nepal, we have two territorial disputes. One is called the Kalapani dispute. And this dispute also includes the others like Limpi, Yadura dispute and the Lipu Lake dispute. And we also have what is called the Sustha dispute. So both these disputes are because of the changing courses of rivers. So Sustha is now part of the state of Bihar, if I am not wrong. So in 1816, when the Treaty of Segauli was signed between the British and the Gorkhas, so Gandak River was identified as the boundary between India and Nepal. So Gandak River was identified as the boundary between India and Nepal. However, Gandak River is a Himalayan river, and you must be knowing that Himalayan rivers frequently change their courses. So they actually are meandering in nature because they are in their youthful stage of erosion. So they have changed their courses. So Gandak has also changed the course. So in 1816, Sustha was part of Nepal, because it was on the right bank of Gandak River. But because of the changing course of the river, it came to the left bank of the river and it became part of India. However, Nepal says that it should be part of Nepal. So Nepal claims Sustha, but it is now administered as part of India. So this is a point which you need to remember. So because of the changing nature of the Gandak River, so this dispute has arisen. So Sustha and Kalapani, both are disputes between India and Nepal. So I think you have understood this. Let us see the next question, question number 7. This is also with respect to disputes. So how many of you can answer this correctly? Scarborough Shoal, which is also called Huangyan Island in the South China Sea, is disputed between China and which country? So let us see how many of you can answer the question number 7 correctly. Okay, so this is a simple question. So I have told you several times that disputes are very, very important for the examination. So if you have followed the South China Sea dispute, you can answer this correctly. So in the South China Sea, there are a group of islands which are called Spratly Islands, which are disputed between China and several other countries in Southeast Asia. And we have the Paracel Islands, which are disputed between China and Vietnam. China has undertaken the construction of artificial islands, and they have also started militarization of these islands. In this South China Sea, we also have a shoal, which is also called Huangyan Island, so Scarborough Shoal. This forms part of the EEZ of a country called Philippines. So it forms part of the EEZ of Philippines, which means it is inside the 200 nautical mile zone. However, this is claimed by China, and they have protested against this action on the part of China. So Scarborough Shoal is a dispute in the South China Sea between China and the Philippines. So the answer is Philippines. So you need to pay focus or pay attention to the disputes in the South China Sea and the East China Sea. There are a number of disputes between China and other countries in the South China Sea as well as the East China Sea. Okay, so let us see the next question, question number 8. The foreign direct investment limit in the defense sector is? What is the FDI limit in the defense sector? Okay, so only two people have answered, and both of them have answered it incorrectly. So the answer is 74%. So you must be knowing this. So very recently, in May 2020, the government of India has announced a package which is called Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. So this package primarily aims at self-reliance. So we need to be self-reliant. As far as various goods and services are concerned, you must be knowing that India heavily relies on imports. Our manufacturing sector is not as strong as other countries, especially China. So we have run a huge trade deficit with China. So in order to overcome these problems, we need to produce the goods and services which are necessary in our country, within our country. And as part of that, we have launched a program called Make in India. So Make in India extends to 25 sectors. So one of the areas where we are attracting investment is in the field of defense. Till recently, the limit was 49%, and it has been increased to 74%. So the FDI limit in the field of defense is 74%, which means that a foreign company can come and invest in India, and they need to collaborate with a local company. So the local company will have a share of 26% and the foreign company will have a share of 74%. FDI, however, has not been forthcoming in the field of defense. We have not succeeded in attracting foreign direct investment in the field of defense. So this is a potential question, not just for the prelims examination, but also for the mains exam. India is one of the largest importers of defense equipment in the world. However, as far as defense exports is concerned, we are ranked 19. So in defense exports, our rank is 19th, and we export just 10,000 crores worth defense equipment to other countries. As far as imports are concerned, we import a lot. I think India is the second largest importer of defense equipment after Saudi Arabia. So after Saudi Arabia, India ranks second. Okay. So this is something which is very, very important for the exam. So FDI limit in the field of defense is 74%. So let us see the next question. consider the following statement. Special 301 report is prepared by the European Union to identify countries with weak intellectual property laws. The second statement is India is placed in the priority watch list of the report. So let us see the answer. Akash Gogoi says the answer is 3. Neelam says the answer is B. What about the others? Okay, so what is the answer? So, for example, special 301 report is prepared by the EU. This is wrong. So, special 301 report is prepared by the United States of America. USA is the country which prepares the special 301 report. So, it is prepared by the United States Trade Representative and it is released every year. And this report identifies countries which have weak intellectual property rights legislation. So, countries which do not give adequate protection to the American companies as far as intellectual property is concerned, that is as far as patents or copyright are concerned, then these countries will be placed in this list. So, this report has three lists. One is called priority foreign country. So, if a country is placed in this list, that is priority foreign country, then sanctions will be imposed on this country. So, as of now, there is no country in this list, but earlier we had countries like Wipro and other countries. Then we have two other lists, which is called priority watch list. Priority watch list. We have some countries, including China and India, in this list. And we also have priority list. So, countries with weak intellectual property laws are placed in these lists. So, these are the three lists. One is priority list, then we have the priority watch list, and we have the priority foreign country. A total of 33 countries are placed in these lists. So, very, very important. So, whenever this report is released, India feels tense because India may be placed in the priority foreign country. So, please remember this. Section 301 of the US Trade Act, so which is called the Trade Act of 1974, requires the US Trade Representative to release the Special 301 report every year. So the answer for this question is, the statement A is wrong, the statement B is correct, so the answer is B only. Okay, so let us see the next question, question number 10. This is a simple question. Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize is announced by which country, which organization? So let me see the answer here. So Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize is announced on May 3rd, which happens to be the Press Freedom Day. So World Press Freedom Day is celebrated on May 3rd. This is the day on which the historic Windhoek Declaration was adopted by African Union. And that is the reason why it is celebrated as the World Press Freedom Day. On this day, we also see the Press Freedom Index. So, Press Freedom Index is released by Reporters Without Borders. So India's rank is 142. India actually is ranked very poorly. On the very day, we also have the Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize. It is released by UNESCO. UNESCO is the organization which is responsible for releasing the World Press Freedom Prize. So it is released and is given to persons, that is journalists, who actually promote free speech even in tough environments. So this year it was given to a Colombian journalist. Her name is Janet Bedoya Lima. So she was given the Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize. So this person, Guillermo Cano, is also a Colombian. So he was killed by the rebels in Colombia, and it is a prize which is named after him. So very, very important prize. Not many people know about this. So Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize is released by UNESCO. So let us see the next question. So I have given you three regions and I have also given three countries. So I have given in the form of pairs. So which is correct? Which of these pairs are correctly matched? So nobody has answered this question. Okay, let us see the answer here. Darfur is not in South Sudan, it is actually in Sudan. So it is in West Sudan. So this is wrong. So Darfur is an area where we are seeing a genocide. So this area is witnessing clashes between the Africans and the Arab militia. Kowloon Peninsula is also not part of Indonesia. It is part of what is called Hong Kong. So when you study about the history of Hong Kong, you might have come across that the fact that Hong Kong comprises of three regions. One is called the Hong Kong Island. The other is Kowloon Peninsula. And the third is New Territories. So these three together form part of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region, so which was handed over to China by the United Kingdom in 1997 under the principle of one nation, two systems. Then Borno, yes, Borno state is in Nigeria. So this is the place where Boko Haram, a dreaded terrorist organization, is very active. So this is in Nigeria. So the answer is C. That is three only, or that is C only. Okay, so let us see here. So this topic is very, very important for the examination. So places in news. So you must be focused on this topic, places in news. So let us see the next question. This is something which is very recently in the news. Davinder Singh versus State of Punjab pertains to which of the following issues? So this is a simple, straightforward question. If you are following the newspaper in the recent period, you can answer this question very easily. So there are two cases which are in the news. So one is called the E.V. Chinnaiah case. So E.V. Chinnaiah versus state of Andhra Pradesh. So in this case, a 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court has held that scheduled castes are a homogeneous group. So they have held that the scheduled castes are a homogeneous group. You cannot categorize. No categorization of scheduled castes can be done. So this is a judgment delivered by a 5-judge bench. And very recently in the Davinder Singh case, the Supreme Court has given an opposite judgment. So in this case, the Supreme Court said yes to categorization. So they said that you cannot treat the scheduled caste as a homogeneous group in order to promote equitable distribution of the benefits of reservation. You need to categorize the scheduled caste. This is what the Supreme Court has said. So Davinder Singh versus state of Punjab basically pertains to the categorization of scheduled caste. So in this context, you must focus on the important judgments delivered by the Supreme Court, the very, very important topic for the examination. So you come across a judgment delivered by Supreme Court on every day. So you need to pay attention to the cases. So you need to know the case in which a particular judgment has been delivered by the Supreme Court. So okay, so let us move on to the next question. Core and buffer zones form a significant part of which of the following conservation areas? So let us see how many of you can answer this. So this we have seen several times. Where do we come across this concept called the core zone and the buffer zone? Okay, let us see the answer here. Core and buffer zones form part of tiger reserves. So there are a total of 50 tiger reserves. So tiger reserves can be national parks or can be a national park or a wildlife sanctuary, which is very, very important for the purpose of tiger conservation. So the fundamental principle as far as tiger reserves are is concerned is the tiger reserve is divided into two zones. The primary area is called the core zone, and this is highly protected. And we also have the buffer zone where limited activities are allowed. So the concept called core and buffer zones are with respect to tiger reserves. Okay, so let us see the next question. The Indian Science Congress 2021 will be hosted by which of the following cities? So let us see this question. This is one of the commonly asked questions. So event and location. Here I have asked you the future event. So the Indian Science Congress 2021. So in 2020, the event was hosted by Bengaluru. So this is the first event which is attended by the Prime Minister. Usually this is held in the first week of January, and the first event which is attended by the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister usually make big announcements as far as science and technology is concerned. So next year it will be held in Pune. So Pune is the city which will be hosting the Indian Science Congress in 2021. So in some situations they may also ask you questions on the future events. So G20 Summit 2021 or the G7 Summit 2021 or the United Nations Framework Convention to Climate Change, COP26. So where will these events be held? So usually they'll ask you questions on the past events, but at times they may ask you questions on the future events also. So you need to be prepared. So the Indian Science Congress 2021 will be held in Pune. The Symbiosis Institute will be hosting the event. Okay, let us see question number 15. The minimum support price is announced on how many crops by the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs? Okay, so what is the answer? The answer for this question is 22. So you must know that the minimum support price is announced by the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs. So it is announced on 22 products. There are two more products which are so Thoria and dehusked coconut. So on these two products also there is what is called minimum support price, but this is based on the minimum support price of Thoria is based on the minimum support price of rapeseed or mustard. So they will not be announcing it separately on the basis of the MSP of Thoria. I mean on the basis of the MSP of rapeseed or mustard, the MSP of Thoria is determined. Similarly for copra, whatever the MSP is announced, it is linked to the dehusked coconut. So MSP is announced on 22 products. The MSP for two other products is based on the MSP of two products in this list, that is rapeseed mustard as well as copra. And on sugarcane we don't have MSP. On sugarcane we have what is called the FRP, fair and remunerative price. So this is also a support price which is announced. So when you are asked to mention like how many products are covered under the support price policy, you can say 25, but MSP is announced on 22. So there is a lot of confusion as far as this question is concerned. MSP is announced on 22 products, two products MSP. So the MSP of two products, that is Thoria and dehusked coconut, is based on the MSP of rapeseed mustard and copra. And for sugarcane, we have the FRP. So please remember this point. So the answer is 22. So let us see the next question. India's rank in the Global Social Mobility Report or index is... So this is a report which was released for the first time, if I am not wrong, by the World Economic Forum. So it basically examines the position of children compared to their parents. So will the children have a better life compared to their parents? So this is what is measured as far as the Global Social Mobility Report is concerned. So for the first report, they have taken 82 countries into consideration. And it is disappointing as far as India is concerned. So the rank of India is 76. So we are ranked 76 out of 82, which means the children in our country may not have a better life compared to their parents. So this is what Global Social Mobility Report basically indicates. So the answer is 3, that is 76. So let us see the next question. Consider the following statements. Bank rate is charged against loans offered by the central bank to commercial banks, whereas repo rate is charged for repurchasing the securities sold by the commercial banks to the central bank. Second statement is, no collateral is involved while charging the bank rate, but securities, bonds, agreements and collateral is involved when repo rate is charged. The third statement is, repo rate is always lower than the bank rate. So I'll give you some time to read these statements carefully before answering. So let us see the statements, examine the statements. So there are four policy rates which are announced by the Reserve Bank of India. So all these are very important. So we have the repo rate, we have the reverse repo rate, we have what is called the marginal standing facility rate, and we also have the bank rate. So let us see the first statement. Bank rate is charged against loans. So when the RBI gives loans to a commercial bank, then the rate that is charged on these loans is called bank rate. Whereas the repo rate is charged on securities which are parked by commercial banks before the central bank. So this statement is correct. So bank rate is charged against loans offered by the central bank to commercial banks, whereas repo rate is charged for purchasing the securities sold by the commercial banks to the central bank. Second, no collateral is involved while charging the bank rate, but securities, bonds, agreements and collateral is involved when repo rate is charged. This is also correct. So you need not give any collateral. So that is a guarantee need not be given when you are taking a loan from the Reserve Bank of India. But the securities, bonds or agreements which are actually parked before the Reserve Bank of India act as a collateral as far as repo rate is concerned. And this is the reason why repo rate is always lower than the bank rate. This is also correct. So repo rate is something which is always lower than the bank rate. So because there is a collateral involved in repo rate, we don't have any collateral. So this is basically short term. This is usually long term. And that is the reason why we have the repo rate, which is always lower than the bank rate. Okay, so let us see the next question. Question number 18. Which of the following is also called the Bonn Convention? Which of these conventions is also called the Bonn Convention? Okay, so let us see the answer here. So Bonn Convention is the other name given to the Convention on Migratory Species. So this convention is basically aimed at conserving. So this convention aims at conserving the migratory species of animals. So those animals which move from one country to other country. For example, we have the Siberian crane, which comes all the way from Siberia to India during the winter months to escape the harsh conditions in Siberia. So Convention on Migratory Species is also called by this name, that is the Bonn Convention. Why is this important? Because a conference of parties, COP number 13 to the Convention on Migratory Species, was held in the month of February, and it was hosted by Gandhinagar. So this convention was hosted by Gandhinagar. So this is very, very important for the examination, a potential question for the CS exam. So Convention on Migratory Species is also called the Bonn Convention. So let us see the next question. Yes, Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Okay, question number 19. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. Oh, cool. So I have given you three cultural practices and I have also given you three states. So which of these pairs are correctly matched? Okay, TS means Telangana. Okay, let us see. Nobody has answered this. So, first cultural practice. Kalamkari is not from Telangana. It is from Andhra Pradesh. So, this is a very famous practice. So, basically this pertains to the handloom industry. So, Kalamkari is from Andhra Pradesh. So, this is not correct. Songs of Shaman. Yes, Arunachal Pradesh. Then we have Haran. That is from Jammu and Kashmir. Haran is a form of folk theatre which is prevalent in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So in this context, I would like to tell you that the Ministry of Culture has recently released the National List of Intangible Cultural Heritage. So you need to take a look at the National List of Intangible Cultural Heritage. Very, very important for the examination. So the Ministry of Culture has released it. So there are, there is a list of 106 cultural practices in this list. So please go through these 106 items, very important. So let us see the next question, question number 20. Lopnor, a nuclear weapons testing base, is located in which country? Okay, so what is the answer? This is a simple, straightforward question. The answer for this is China. So every country has their own nuclear testing base or nuclear testing place. We have Pokhran, in Rajasthan, which is the site for nuclear testing in 1974 and 1998. Similarly, Lopnor in Xinjiang province in China. So this province is inhabited by the Uyghurs. So it is often in the news. So this is located in the Taklamakan Desert. And this is the place where China conducts its nuclear weapons testing. So very recently they have conducted a nuclear test, it seems. So which has become very controversial. So several months ago. So let us see the next question, 21. Consider the following statements. The Paris Climate Agreement was signed at the Conference of Parties number 21. Second is, penalties will be imposed on countries if they don't adhere to the provisions of the Paris Climate Agreement. Okay, let us see the first statement. The Paris Climate Agreement was signed at the Conference of Parties number 21. Yes, this is correct. So this is an event which was held in 2015, and in this historic Conference of Parties, the Paris Climate Agreement was clinched. So this is a correct statement. Then the other statement is, penalties will be imposed on countries if they don't adhere to the provisions of the Paris Climate Agreement. This is wrong. So Paris Climate Agreement, so the nationally determined contributions which the countries submit before the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change Secretariat. So the national determined contributions are NDCs, so they are not binding. So even if the country does not implement the NDCs, there will be no penalties. So the answer for this is A only. So very, very important. That is a major criticism of the Paris Climate Change Agreement. Unlike the Kyoto Protocol, which imposed penalties on countries who have not implemented their promises, the Paris Climate Change Agreement does not have any such penalties. So let us see the next question. Under the Climate Ambition Alliance, nations renew their push to upscale action by 2020 and achieve net zero carbon dioxide emissions by which year? Under the Climate Ambition Alliance. So this is an alliance which was adopted in COP25. COP25 was held in Madrid. So the most important outcome of this Conference of Parties is the Climate Ambition Alliance, which was launched by Chile. So 73 countries have joined this alliance. So under this alliance, nations have agreed to upscale action by 2020 and achieve net zero carbon dioxide emissions by which year? So I'll just read here. I think you cannot see this. So under the Climate Ambition Alliance, nations renew their push to upscale action by 2020 and achieve net zero carbon dioxide emissions by which year? So let us see the answer here. The answer is, this is a straightforward factual question. So the answer is 2050. So nations have agreed that they will be achieving what is called net carbon dioxide, net zero carbon dioxide emissions by the year 2050. Second is also related to climate change. So this topic is very, very important for the examination, prelims exam. So you must pay attention to this particular topic. You must follow all the developments as far as climate change is concerned. So let us see the next question. The Secretariat of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change is located in where do we have the Secretariat of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change? Okay, so the answer for this question is Bonn. Bonn is a city in Germany, and this is the place which hosts the Secretariat, that is the headquarters of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. So this was in the news because when the Conference of Parties number 25 was cancelled, so it was supposed to be hosted by Chile. When it got cancelled, the organizers were looking for an alternative. So many people said that Bonn may be taken as an alternative, but the German government said that they may not be in a position to arrange the logistics at this place. So that is the reason why they have chosen Madrid as the place for hosting this event. So Bonn is the place which hosts the Secretariat of the UNFCCC. Which of the following is the lowest investment grade rating given by S&P? So we are now often seeing these investment ratings given by organizations like S&P, Moody and Fitch. So which is the lowest investment grade? Okay, so nobody has answered this. So the answer for this is BBB-. So this is the rating which is also given to India. So India has now the lowest investment grade rating. So the country still offers investment grade. So below this we have what is called speculative ratings. So which means all categories in C and D form part of speculative categories. We have the lowest investment rating that is given to India, that is BBB-. So in this context, please look into the ratings given by S&P, Moody and Fitch. So these are the three prominent sovereign credit rating agencies, and they rate countries on the basis of a number of parameters. So please look into the rating given by these agencies to India. So the number of tribes classified as particularly vulnerable tribal groups are. So this is a simple question. So the number of tribes which are classified as PVTG. So let us see the answer here. So particularly vulnerable tribal groups are scheduled tribes which are most backward. So they are the most backward among the scheduled tribes. So we have a total of more than 740 tribes that are designated as scheduled tribes by the government of India. So there is a list of STs which is called the Constitution ST order, scheduled tribes order 1950. So there are more than a 740 or 744 tribes to be precise which have been designated as scheduled tribes in our country. Out of these, 75 tribes are classified as PVTG, so particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So they are characterized by low literacy, extreme backwardness, low population growth, and their population numbers also is very low, so less population. So there are a total of 75 groups. The state which has the highest number of particularly vulnerable tribal groups is Odisha. Odisha has the highest number of PVTG tribes. Okay, so this is something which is important. There is a scheme which is run by the central government for promoting the welfare of the particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So this topic is in the news because some people within the Great Andamanese tribe have actually tested positive for COVID-19. So there are just 74 individuals of that particular group left on this planet, and out of them 5 have tested positive. So concerns are actually raised regarding the safety of these people. So that is the reason why it was in the news. So let us see the next question. Consider the following statements. So let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. Both Turkey and Greece are members of NATO. Second, Greece is a member of the European Union, but Turkey is not. The third statement is Cyprus is a member of both NATO and the European Union. So which of these are correct? Okay, let us see the answer here. Both Turkey and Greece are members of NATO. This is a correct statement. In fact, this is quite surprising because both these countries are now engaged in a dispute as far as the oil and natural gas resources are concerned in the Eastern Mediterranean. So first is both Turkey and Greece are members of NATO. So in fact, they should help each other when they are attacked by an external country, but these two countries are fighting. Second statement is Greece is a member of European Union, but Turkey is not. This is also correct. So Turkey wants to be a member of the European Union, but its membership has been objected by Greece. So membership of the EU is given on the basis of consensus. So Turkey has been trying to be part of the European Union, but because of the Cyprus dispute which Greece has with Turkey, they are not part of the European Union. The third statement is Cyprus is a member of both NATO and the European Union. This is wrong. Cyprus is a member of the European Union, but it is not a member of NATO. So the answer for this question is A and C only. So Cyprus is a member of European Union, but it is not a member of NATO. So this is something which you need to know. Very important for the examination. So there is a dispute that is intensifying with every passing day in the Eastern Mediterranean region. So let us see question number 27. Consider the following statements on PSLV. PSLV is a four-stage launch vehicle with two liquid and two solid stages. PSLV XL and DL versions have 6 and 4 strap-on boosters respectively. Okay, so in this context, you must know the launch vehicles which are developed by India. So there are two prominent launch vehicles developed by India. One is PSLV and the other is GSLV. You must know the features of both these launch vehicles. Very, very important for the examination. So you must study the features of GSLV as well as PSLV. So when you study about the PSLV, which is one of the most successful launch vehicles in the world, so you will study that PSLV is a four-stage launch vehicle with two liquid and two solid stages. Yes, it is correct. So solid, liquid. So this is the four stages. The first stage is using the solid fuel, second liquid, third solid, fourth liquid. So first is correct. So there are various variants. So there are various types of PSLV vehicles. So there are four variants, primary variants. So one is PSLV core alone. So in this, there are no strap-on boosters. So there are no boosters which are attached to the PSLV. Then we have PSLV DL version, and it has two strap-on boosters. We have PSLV QL version. It has four strap-on boosters. And we have the PSLV XL version, which has six strap-on boosters. So the strap-on boosters are attached to give additional thrust to the PSLV launch vehicle. So if it is carrying a heavy satellite, then it requires additional thrust, and this is offered by the strap-on boosters. So there are variants of the PSLV used depending on the weight of the payload. So this is something which you need to know. So it is wrong. So because I have given you 6 and 4, but it is 6 and 2. So the answer is one only. So something which is very important. So let us see the next question. Consider the following statements. India's quota, or India with a quota of 2.76%, is fourth in the list of countries having the highest quota. So consider the following statements on IMF, Indian International Monetary Fund quotas. So this is this actually question. Sorry. Consider the following statements on IMF quotas. So first statement is India with a quota of 2.76% is the fourth in the list of countries having the highest quota. USA is the only country which enjoys veto power on key decisions in the IMF. So let us see the answer here. So this is a very important topic, IMF. There is always a controversy with respect to the quotas in IMF. India and several other emerging countries have complained that they are not adequately represented in the voting system as well as the quota system of the IMF. So India with a quota of 2.76%. So 2.76% is correct, but India is not fourth in the list. India is eighth in the list. So this is a wrong statement. So the second statement is US is the only country which enjoys veto power on key IMF decisions. This is correct, because key IMF decisions which require the support of countries which have together 85% voting rights. So countries must vote on key decisions and together they should have 85% voting rights. USA itself has approximately 17% voting right, which means that if USA says no, then that proposal will not be taken forward, because if USA says no, even if all other countries join hands, they will not account for 85% of the voting rights. So this is something which you need to know. So the answer is this is wrong and this is correct, so which means B only. So let us see the next question. Sakharov Prize is awarded in which of the following categories? So please study about IMF and the quota system. That is important even for the mains examination. So nobody has answered this. The Sakharov Prize is announced by the European Union. So it is announced by the Parliament of the European Union. So EU Parliament announces the Sakharov Prize. It is given in the field of human rights. So human rights is the answer. So the latest recipient. So in 2019, this was given to a Uyghur rights activist, Ilham Toti. So this person, who is a Chinese person, but he fights for the rights of the Uyghurs. So he is an economist and a human rights activist. So, and this person was given the Sakharov Prize 2019. So very important. So let us see the next question. This is a simple question. Hunar Haat is an event organized by which of the following ministries? Okay, so this is an event. Hunar Haat is an event which is organized under a scheme called Ustad scheme. So it has actually gained a lot of attention. So this is an event which is organized by the Ministry of Minority Affairs. So Hunar Haat is basically an exhibition which is conducted by the Ministry of Minority Affairs. So people belonging to the minority community can display their skills, especially persons who are engaged in making handicrafts, that is artisans and craftsmen, and cooks, so whoever has cooking skills can display their skills in these events. And this event is basically organized to provide employment opportunities to these people. Okay, so Hunar Haat is something which is organized by the Ministry of Minority Affairs. So let us see the next question. Vajra scheme is launched by. So this actually option is not there. I am very sorry. But can you tell me which is the ministry which has launched the Vajra scheme? Vajra scheme is launched by which ministry? So I have made a mistake here. I forgot to include the correct option. So Vajra scheme, this is a very important scheme which has attracted a lot of attention. So the answer is it is a scheme of the Department of Science and Technology or the Ministry of Science and Technology. So Visiting Advanced Joint Research Program. So under this scheme, India is encouraging NRIs to come to India and carry out their research in publicly funded universities. So they are asked to come to India and carry out their research in Indian universities. So this is a very important scheme. So this is a scheme of the Ministry of Science and Technology. So let us see the next question. This is a simple straightforward question. Consider the following pairs. I have given you four policy rates and I have given the numbers. So as on today, so what is the rates? So what is the answer? So let us see the rates here. So repo rate, as of now, the repo rate is 4%. It is not 4.25%. So A is incorrect. Then the reverse repo rate, 3.35%. This is correct. Then MSF rate, this is also correct, 4.25%. Bank rate is 4.25%. As I've already told you, bank rate is always higher than the repo rate. So repo rate is 4%, bank rate is 4.25%. So the answer is A and D only. Okay, so let us see the next question. East Turkestan Islamic Movement is active in which of the following countries? This is something which is simple. This movement has been designated as a terrorist organization by the United States of America. So where is this movement actually active? East Turkestan Islamic Movement is active in which of the following nations? So let us see the answer. So East Turkestan Islamic Movement is a movement which is organized by some of the Uyghurs. So it is designated as a terrorist movement and this is aimed at creating independence for Xinjiang, which is the region in China which is inhabited by the Uyghurs. So the answer is China. So China is the country where we have the East Turkestan Islamic Movement. So let us see the next question. Which of the following articles in the Constitution of India deals with the inclusion of a group or community in the list of scheduled tribes? Which of the following articles in the Constitution of India deals with the inclusion of a group or community in the list of scheduled tribes? So let us see the answer. So this is a straightforward question. Article 341 deals with the inclusion of a community in the SC community group. So 342 ST. So 341 and 342 basically deal with SC and ST respectively. So it is under this article that the president releases the list, and the changes can be made to this list only by the parliament. So the answer is 342. So let us see the next question. The International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea is based in which city? So where are the headquarters of the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea? Okay, so what is the answer? The answer is, this is a simple question, so you must have come across the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea when you were studying this Italian Marines case. So the answer for this question is Hamburg. So Hamburg is the city. So Hamburg is a city in Germany, and this is the place where the headquarters of the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea is located. So let us see the next question. When the office of the speaker and deputy speaker are vacant, the duties of the office shall be performed by. So who shall perform the duties of the office of the speaker and the deputy speaker if both these offices are vacant? So nobody has answered this question. So see here, this is a very important question. So the keyword here is vacant. So if there is any vacancy which may be caused due to death or disqualification or by any other reason, so if both the offices of the speaker and deputy speaker are vacant, then the duties of the speaker will be performed by any member of the house selected by the president of India. So this is something which is very, very important. So the key word here is vacancy. Then there is another word which is called absent. So if these two people are absent, so when the speaker is absent, these performance of these duties will be done by deputy speaker. If he is also absent, then there is a panel of speakers who will be performing the duties. So in case of vacancy, the duties are performed by a person who is selected by the president as this speaker to do this function temporarily. And if there is an absence, sorry, if there is any absence, then just hold on. Okay, so when there is an absence, then it is performed by any of the panel members of the speaker. So this is something which you need to note, and this is mentioned in Article 95 of the Constitution of India. Okay, so let us see the next question. Consider the following monuments: Apatani Cultural Landscape, Chilka Lake, Ekarma Kshetra, and Mughal Gardens in Kashmir. So which of these are included in the tentative list of the World Heritage Sites? So let us see the answer here. So you must know that India has 38 World Heritage Sites. All these are very important for the examination. You must also know that before a site is designated as a World Heritage Site, it must be placed in a list called tentative list. So there are two lists which are very important for the examination. One is the World Heritage Site list, which includes the World Heritage Sites, and there is another list which is prepared by India. And the UNESCO examines monuments or landscapes that are mentioned in the tentative list to check whether they are fit to be declared as a World Heritage Site. And only after examining the tentative list will they declare any one or two monuments as a World Heritage Site. So the answer is Apatani. So you can look at this list. It is available even in the Wikipedia. So Apatani Cultural Landscape, one of the most beautiful places in our country, in Arunachal Pradesh. So this is there in this list. So it is there. Chilka Lake, yes. Ekarma Kshetra, Bhubaneswar, this is also there. Mughal Gardens of Kashmir, this is also there. So answer is all the above. Okay, so this is something which is very, very important for the examination. So please study both these lists, World Heritage Site list as well as the tentative list. Okay, so let us see the next question. Which of the following categories has the highest weightage in the consumer price index? So consumer price index is based on six categories. I have given you four here. So there are two other categories. So the question is quite simple. So which category has the highest weightage? So the other categories are clothing and footwear and the miscellaneous category. So which category has the highest weightage? So the answer is food and beverages. So food and beverages is the category which actually has the highest weightage. Consumer price index is very important for the examination because this forms the basis of calculating inflation in India. So the Monetary Policy Committee looks into the numbers, that is the CPI numbers, while determining the key rates, that is the key policy rates. So it should be around 4% according to the MPC. So let us see the next question. Consider the following nations: Brunei, Bahrain, Oman, the United States of America. Which of these are members of OPEC Plus? Okay, so let us see the answer for this question. OPEC Plus is an organization. It is actually an informal grouping of 23 countries. So these 23 countries include 13 members of OPEC plus 10 other major oil producing nations. So this is a very important group. It is always in the news. OPEC Plus is an informal group. So this is not a formal group like OPEC. It is an informal group which was created to stabilize oil prices. So this group actually has been created to stabilize oil prices. The key member in the OPEC Plus group outside OPEC is Russia. However, you need to know that USA is the largest producer of crude. It is the largest producer of crude in the world, but it is not a member of OPEC or OPEC Plus. So the answer for this question is A, B and C only. Brunei, Bahrain and Oman are members of OPEC Plus, but they are, USA is not a member. Okay, so let us see the next question. Which of the following is the nodal agency for promoting foreign direct investment in India? Which of these organizations is responsible for promoting FDI in India? So the answer for this question, nobody has answered this. So the answer is DPIIT. So DPIIT stands for the Department for the Promotion of Internal Trade, Industry and Internal Trade. So Department for the Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade is the organization which is responsible for attracting FDI into India. Which of the following statements is correct regarding a private members bill? So this is a simple question. Which among the following is correct regarding a private members bill? So first is, it cannot be introduced by the nominated member of the house. It can bring amendment to the constitution. A private members bill originating in the state legislature cannot be reserved for the consideration of the president. And lastly, no private members bill has been passed in the parliament so far. Okay, let us see the answer. So first, it cannot be introduced by the nominated member of the house. This is wrong. It can be introduced by the nominated member. Second, it can bring an amendment to the constitution. This is correct. Third, a private member's bill originating in the state legislature cannot be reserved for the consideration of the president. So there is nothing mentioned in the constitution that it should not be reserved. It can be reserved for the consideration of the president. No private members' bills have been passed in the parliament so far. This is also incorrect. So far, 14 private members' bills have been passed. The last bill to have been passed in the parliament was way back in 1970. But since 1970, we have not seen any private members' bill getting passed by both the houses of the parliament. But in 2014, I think a private members' bill was passed in the Rajya Sabha, but it was not passed in the Lok Sabha. So very important. Let us see the next question. Which of the following companies was recently accorded the status of a Maharatna by the government of India? Okay, so the answer for this question is Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. So Power Grid Corporation of India was recently accorded. So it was accorded Maharatna status by the government of India. So as on today, there are 10 Maharatnas. So the most profit making public sector enterprises are given this status. So there is some criteria which must be fulfilled. So they should have a turnover of 25,000 crores per annum. They should have a net worth of 15,000 crores and they should generate a profit of 5,000 crores per annum. They should have significant international presence and they should be listed in the Indian Stock Exchange. So these are the five conditions that are prescribed for designating any organization as a Maharatna, and it should also enjoy Navaratna status. So it should be a Navaratna company before being designated as a Maharatna. So HPCL and Power Grid Corporation of India became the latest to become Maharatnas. Okay, so let us see the next question. Consider the following statements. An ordinary bill is introduced under Article 3 of the Constitution in the Parliament subsequent to President's approval for changing the name of the state. Bills that seek to change the name of a state are passed by a simple majority in both the houses of the Parliament. Okay, let us see the answer for this question. So first statement is an ordinary bill is introduced under Article 3 of the Constitution in the Parliament subsequent to President's approval for changing the name of the state. This is correct. So if you wish to create a new state or if you change the name of the state or if you want to change the boundaries, then we need an ordinary bill to do so. However, this ordinary bill requires the President's approval. Usually ordinary bills do not require the president's approval, but ordinary bills introduced under Article 3 of the Constitution of India require the approval of the president. So this is something which is important. So first statement is correct. Bills that seek to change the name of a state are passed by a simple majority by both the houses of the parliament. This is also correct. So the answer is both A and B. Both A and B are correct as far as this is concerned. Let us see question number 44. India will join hands with which of the following nations in launching the lunar polar exploration? So with which nation are we developing this mission called the lunar polar exploration? So the answer for this question is Japan. So this is a mission which is scheduled to be launched in 2024. India will be collaborating with Japan to launch the lunar polar exploration. So let us see the last question for this exam. So which of the following constitutional amendment acts modified the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India? Which of these constitutional amendment acts modified the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India? So as you all know, Schedule 8 includes the scheduled languages. So there are a total of 22 scheduled languages, but when the constitution entered into force, there were only 14 scheduled languages. So which of these constitutional amendments modified Schedule 8? So the answer, let us see, 86th Constitution Amendment Act, no, this is wrong. 91st, this is also wrong. 54th, this is also wrong. Then 21st constitutional amendment, this is correct. So we have three constitutional amendments. So the 21st Constitutional Amendment Act added Sindhi to the list of scheduled languages. Then we have the 71st Constitutional Amendment Act, which added Kashmiri, Manipuri and Nepali to this list. And we have the 92nd Constitutional Amendment Act, which added Bodo, Dogri, Maithali and Santali. So these four were added. So the answer is 21st. So Schedule 8 was changed by three constitutional amendments, 21, 71 and 92. It is not 91. 91 basically deals with the strength of the Council of Ministers. So these are the 45 questions. We have run out of time. So we still have 5 questions, but I think we will be doing the 5 questions in the next class. So very soon, I think every day we will be having the examination at the same time, 6 o'clock, 5:36. So please participate in the examination. So this will be added to the next exam. So thank you so much for participating. I am very sorry, Neelam. So please use my code RRUPSC when you subscribe to Unacademy. So you will get a 10% additional discount if you use this code. So thank you for participating actively. So thank you Akash, Neelam and others who have actively participated, and have a good day.